Voyager 2 is back online after a year. Hi, we're going to talk about the Voyager mission. Have you ever heard of it? It's one of the most famous space exploration missions of all time and was planned by NASA some decades ago. The goal of this video is twofold. The first thing we want to do is explain what is the Voyager mission and why it has been such an important one in the history of space exploration. The second thing we want to do instead is try to debunk some misconceptions that have been built around this mission. In particular, we want to better explain what we mean when we say NASA lost communication with Voyager. We'd like to give you the best information possible because science is not based upon misconceptions. It's based upon crystal clear facts that always have a precise meaning or explanation. Keep watching the video and you'll soon realize that we humans are very good at space exploration and no, we didn't lose communication with Voyager 2 for a year. So basically, in the 70s, NASA had the fantastic idea to send spacecraft outside of the solar system in the interstellar space. It was like, okay, let's go where nothing from Earth has flown before. Let's see what we find. This idea came to mind in the summer of 1965. At that time, some precise calculations revealed it was possible for us to launch a spacecraft in the late 70s to visit all four giant outer planets, using the gravity of each planet to swing the probe onto the next. This sort of alignment is quite rare. It's called a launch window, and it occurs once every 176 years. So if one wanted to launch such a spacecraft, it would have been pretty quick. In July of 1972, the project began. It was first dubbed Mariner Mission, but then NASA announced the name would have been Voyager. The original plans for this mission were pretty simple. They wanted to make a grand tour of the solar system, flying Jupiter and Saturn before exiting the solar system. The two spacecraft, Voyager 1 and 2, were launched respectively on September and August of 1977 from NASA's Kennedy Space Center. As you can see, there is something weird going on between names and launch dates. The first to have been launched chronologically was Voyager 2. It was named Voyager 2 because even though it launched first, it was planned to reach Jupiter and Saturn after Voyager 1. In September of 1977, one day after its launch, Voyager 1 sent us a photo of Earth and Moon from its own point of view. Then in November of 1980, it was time for Saturn. Voyager 1 made its closest approach to Saturn's largest moon, Titan, and Saturn, giving us beautiful pictures and precious scientific data. The beauty of this encounter, however, lies in the discovery of three of Saturn's moons, Atlas, Prometheus, and Pandora. This gave us a better understanding of moon atmospheres and compositions. Voyager 2 reached Saturn a year later, and in January of 1986, it encountered Uranus. This was the first time the seventh astonishing blue planet from the Sun had been seen up close. Upon approach, images revealed 11 new moons. All of them were given beautiful names, such as Juliet, Ophelia, and Bianca. Voyager 2 was also the first to image Uranus's very dark rings and to detect temperatures as low as -353°, 59 Kelvin, which made Uranus the coldest planet in our solar system. But this encounter was a challenging one to detect from Earth. In fact, as spacecraft go further and further away from the Earth, their signal gets low, and we have hard times trying to detect it. For the occasion, NASA's Deep Space Network, which enables Earth to communicate with spacecraft beyond the moon, arrayed antennas together to improve our ability to capture the weak radio signals from very distant spacecraft. And it, of course, succeeded. In August of 1987, NASA expanded its ears, meaning that bigger dishes and all three communication complexes in Goldstone, Madrid, and Canberra substituted smaller ones. This, of course, improved our resolution and was a good thing, since Voyager was soon expected to send back signals from Neptune. When the Voyager mission reached the distance of about 4 billion miles from the Sun, it took the last images of the mission. Such images were capturing Venus, Earth, Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, and Neptune, and the collage of them made up the so-called solar system family portrait. There, the Earth can be seen as a pale blue dot, as Carl Sagan said. As we've said, these were the last images taken from Voyager because engineers turned off Voyager 1's cameras in order to save some power for other instruments that would have collected key data on the solar wind and interstellar space once the spacecraft would have left the solar system. In 2004, Voyager 1 crossed the shock, meaning the termination shock into the heliosheath, the outer layer of the bubble the sun blows around itself and all of the planets. In 2007, it was time for Voyager 2 instead. In 2012 and 2018, Voyager 1 and 2 finally entered the interstellar space, passing beyond the heliopause. This, ladies and gentlemen, was the first time a human-made object crossed the threshold of interstellar space. Can you believe it? This makes landing on the moon look like a trip to the shops. The probes themselves were built with 1970s technology, and the most advanced processors would have been under 1 megabyte. Voyager 2 is incredibly primitive compared to what is available today. Just think about your smartphone, for example. It is way more sophisticated. V2 has traveled 11 billion miles, controlled from here for 43 of its 44 years, taking photographs and collecting other information, then sending the info back to Earth. But now let's get to the real point. In 2020, Voyager 2 had some problems. People were concerned about this, and newspapers all around the world were talking about it. On January 25th, the probe, which has been exploring interstellar space since November 2018, failed to execute a spin maneuver as intended. As a result, two onboard systems remained on longer than planned, sucking up so much energy that Voyager 2 automatically shut off its science instruments. This is pretty much what happened. There's no need to be surprised. I mean, we're speaking of a spacecraft that has been traveling through space for 43 years, and it is now the farthest human object ever made. Every so often, something goes wrong. It would be very unusual if it didn't. But luckily, the mission's managers on our planet know what to do when such a fault occurs. Although it takes about a day and a half to talk to Voyager 2 at its current distance, they sent commands to restore its normal operations. And everything was perfectly fine. The problem was fixed. Is this the end of the story? Of course not, because they went on saying that there was something wrong with Voyager 2. The reality of facts is that starting from March 2020, engineers were not able to communicate with the probe. And here we are. We should explain what we mean by engineers are not able to communicate with the probe. And also, we should explain that this is not due to a malfunction of the probe. Let's see what really happened. Upgrades and repairs are prompting NASA to take offline a key piece of space-age equipment used to beam messages all around the solar system. The downtime was necessary because of a flood of new missions to Mars scheduled to leave Earth in summer of 2020. But the temporary shutdown also highlighted that the deep space network, an essential infrastructure relied upon NASA and other space agencies, was aging and in need of expensive upgrades. Why? Well, it's simple if we think bigger. We are talking about Voyager 1 and 2 spacecraft, but have you ever wondered how many spacecraft NASA is trying to communicate with at this exact moment? It is an armada of spacecraft. These long-distance calls require the most powerful radio antennas in the world. Luckily, NASA has its own switchboard, the Deep Space Network, or DSN. The DSN is one of space exploration's most valuable assets. It comprises one station in the United States in Goldstone, California, and two overseas in Canberra, Australia, and Madrid. It has been in operation nonstop for 57 years, and without it, spacecraft that traveled beyond the moon couldn't communicate with Earth. It is used not only by NASA, but also by the European Space Agency and the space programs of Japan, India, and soon even the United Arab Emirates. Each station on Earth is outfitted with three 34-meter antennas and one 70-meter antenna. They switch back and forth depending on where a spacecraft is concerning our planet. Because of Voyager 2's trajectory relative to Earth, it can talk to only one station and one antenna in the network, Canberra's 70-meter dish, also known as DSS-43. And that dish needed to be improved for the new Mars missions, prompting a shutdown and temporary dismantlement. All of this, however, was perfectly fine, and it was a risk that we had to take. We understand that the situation was like this. Voyager 2 could communicate with us, signals from the probe were reaching us, and we could collect data. The bad thing is that if something again would have gone wrong, we would not be able to fix it because we couldn't communicate with the spacecraft. That was the problem. As you can see, some newspaper titles were misleading and led to a bad understanding of what was going on. Because Voyager 2 is considered a geriatric spacecraft, losing contact with it for any length of time was risky. The antenna, however, went perfectly back on track on February of 2021, and we re-established contact with the probe. We would like to end this video by giving you some precious information about the Voyager mission. It was the mission of some firsts. For example, it was the first spacecraft to cross the heliosphere and venture into interstellar space. It also discovered a thin ring around Jupiter and two new Jovian moons, Theba and Metis. At Saturn, Voyager 1 found a new ring called the G-ring. Also, Voyager 1 and its sister ship Voyager 2 have been flying longer than any other spacecraft in human history. And last but not least, a fun fact, Voyager 1 carries a copy of the Golden Record, a message from humanity to the cosmos. Among other things, it includes greetings in 55 languages and music ranging from Chuck Berry's Johnny B. Goode and Beethoven's classical music. All of this tells us that we humans are very good explorers with good music taste. That's all for this video. Thanks for watching, everyone. What are your feelings about the Voyager mission? Let us know in the comments below. See you soon on the channel.